A sleepless night in the city. No peace and quiet in the city. It's hotter than the water.
Hi, this is Vivian Mead with Progressive Pulse, and we're here with Spencer Day. How are you doing, Spencer?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm great. So I wanted to talk to you about your new CD Vagabond. I see that you kind of go between LA, San Francisco, and New York. Do you live up to that name, or?
At least for the last couple of years, we're definitely living up to that name. I think a lot of people can too, so hopefully it's something that people can relate to. I feel like everyone's a little bit of a vagabond these days.
And I was listening to the CD, and there's a lot of songs that tell stories. I mean, I like how you paint the imagery.
I like to write from a place that I feel like I can understand, even if I've not specifically had that experience myself. And with that one, I really wanted to paint like a film noir kind of landscape. We have like the blinking neon sign, and you can, you know, the people fighting through the wall. And I haven't specifically had that experience, but that's what's fun about songwriting is you can find yourself in an experience that you may not have even had though. What I really liked about that is I wanted to describe the cracks on the wall and kind of set the scene, but not actually mention that you're missing someone or that, you know, there's a person who's got a lot of heartbreak, but kind of save that for later. So even without saying it, I love creating a mood, and I feel like that song, we do a good job of that.
Yeah, and the cracks on the, I mean, that stuck in my head. I could see somebody just looking up there and daydreaming. So I love that song.
It's cool. Beautiful. Thank you.
So a lot of your style is, I mean, it's kind of like a throwback. I understand that you like Cole Porter, Gershwin, but then there's, I mean, I hear a lot of, you know, vocals that are very current. Can you describe your style?
Well, I think I've always been pretty schizophrenic musically in my taste. I grew up in a really small town in northern Utah, which was very religious, and so we didn't have any access to any films except for G-rated movies. And so early on, it was either Disney movies or MGM musicals, and I think that kind of opted for the latter. So I think from a very early age with my mom, we were singing along to Judy Garland and Gene Kelly and Chet Baker, Ella Fitzgerald. But my grandparents loved a lot of country music. They loved Patsy Cline and Marty Robbins and Les Paul and Mary Ford were huge influences. And I think when I moved to California when I was 19, I really got into singer-songwriters like Fiona Apple and Radiohead. And so for me, I don't think in terms of whether it's good or bad music. I just think in terms of whether it's honest and whether it communicates something. And so I think if people hear a little bit of all those things, they're probably right, because I can listen to anything as long as I feel like there's a through line of honesty.
And I get kind of a sense of there's some nostalgia in there in your voice and just the era that you bring back.
Sure.
But you write your own music. A lot of people with that, you know, style tend to sing standards, but you've chosen to write your own music, which is impressive. So how did you get into the writing piece of it?
Well, in a way, it's almost like I felt like the marketplace was already full, you know, with people who do that better than I. And so I feel like that's kind of my one angle that I don't see other people doing as much is taking my love for the Great American Songbook and this classic aesthetic sound of, you know, anywhere from the 30s up through the late 50s, and bringing my love of that sound, but then trying to put it in a modern context that people can still relate to. And I think it was just because my first gigs were playing retirement homes, actually. So that's where I learned a lot of really obscure songs from even like the 1910s, 1920s. And I think through that, I really fell in love with these songs, and they really informed my writing sensibilities. And so I took my love of that, along with my love of Radiohead and Rufus Wainwright and all that, and it just kind of all morphed together. And then I just found myself writing. It wasn't like a conscious decision, like I'm going to write to be different. I just felt like I had something to say.
In the shade of a weeping willow.
And it kind of tells the story from the tree's point of view. Talk about that. How did that come about?
Well, I grew up, the town I grew up in, we had a willow tree in our front yard, and I had a lot of really fond memories under it. And when I went back to the town I grew up in, the tree had died, the house is boarded up, and the neighborhood had kind of suffered from, you know, blight. And for me, I wanted to give the tree a characteristic because when I was there, I just had a really, I was overcome with this really strong sense of how finite time is and how precious the moment is too. So in a way, I like to endow, whether it's a tree or a clock or whatever, you know, with kind of a more profound living personality. And for me, that was just an example of noticing how you should cherish the moment, because the moment had definitely passed when I went back to that place.
It's a beautiful song.
Thank you.
I was also reading that you helped co-write a musical in San Francisco. Tell me about that.
Well, that was a few years ago, and it was just a few friends who got together, and we started kind of improvising a show, and then the next thing we know, we were putting it on in San Francisco at a theater and doing a run and getting reviewed, which for us was a little intense because we had just started out as friends putting it together and saying, let's put on a show. But musicals are like a huge love of mine, and I think ultimately, I mean, I like singing and performing. I love it. But I love being an impresario too, and being kind of behind the scenes. So I'm really excited to do more of that and write for the stage.
Now, you were acting in that. Any other acting gigs in your near future?
There are a few that are kind of in the works. I don't know if I can, you know, they're still being worked out right now. But yeah, and I'm actually really excited about that too. I think it's been in the last few years I've realized that if you are singing, you are acting. It may not seem like it, right, but you're still creating a mood and a character. Even if it's a song that you personally wrote about your life experiences, it's still got to be different every night you do it. And and for some of these songs, like the Joe one, where it's you're still playing make-believe, and right, so I'm excited to play make-believe for pay.
Excellent, we'll look out for those. One last song I wanted to ask you about, because I was listening to it.
Maybe I'll take a walk downtown, maybe I'll hang around the house, maybe the world.
Well, it's kind of like someone having a panic attack, the song, a little bit, you know. For me, it's a little bit humorous, so I wanted to start with these very small things, like you'll take a walk downtown, you know, and then suddenly going to these really grand and huge questions about, you know, like, is there a God, is there, you know, and someone kind of freaking out, and then it kind of, so it's like a huge crescendo, so there's a big wave musically, and then it kind of goes back down to maybe it's all inside my head, you know. And for me, I just feel like I've had that so many times where I'm driving on the road and I'm just overwhelmed by like the humanity of it all. And then I'm looking around at the other cars and I'm like, how is anything functioning? Like if I have this, you know, dialogue going on inside my head, just how is the world running at all? And so for me, that was just like, you know, that's why I wanted to call it Tuesday morning, because it just, you know, it was just a typical early morning freak out.
You know, I could relate to it, definitely. That was,
yeah.
But that's a great song, because like I said, once you listen to the lyrics, it really takes you on a journey and then back again. So Vagabond, you have the three cities that you go between. Any favorites?
I you know, I love them all for different things. Like here in L.A., it's I can get up in the morning and go surfing at the beach. And, you know, San Francisco, you can get the best coffee in the country. And then New York, you know, artistically, I can hear like world-class musicians at 3 in the morning. So it's really tough for me to choose. I think at the moment I'm feeling New York calling a little, so I'm kind of excited to spend a little time back there.
New York, keep an eye out for Spencer Day, and check out the website for future dates in your city. Thank you, Spencer.
Thank you.
In this low-end whack of broken-down hotels.